Hi everyone, and welcome to Jane Talks Real. It's Trek Tuesday, where I will be discussing and reviewing an episode of the original series, The Next Generation, Voyager, Deep Space Nine, or Enterprise. Today I'm going to be looking at Displaced, from Voyager's third season. Or as I like to call it, that time, this ensign was the captain. We start the episode with B'Elanna storming out of the holodeck. Tom is super enthusiastic about the Klingon martial arts program they've been doing, but B'Elanna is not in the mood, and looks like she's about to shove her batleth where the sun don't shine. She was forced into it because she lost a bet, but she's done, thank you very much. And after Tom calls her hostile, some confused dude suddenly appears, asking where he is. And into the credits we go. The guy thinks he's been abducted, and B'Elanna isn't helping by brandishing her weapon. He says he was walking home, and then suddenly he was here. But it's too cold and bright for him, so they take him to sickbay. The alien describes what happened and where he's from, but Janeway says she's not sure where the colony is in relation to Voyager. The doctor runs some scans and asks Tuvok to assist him because Kes failed to turn in for a shift. When they try to locate her, the computer says she's not on board. In fact, she disappeared the exact same moment the alien appeared, but I'm sure that's just a coincidence. In engineering, Harry and B'Elanna are trying to work out what happened, and she goes over to check on something and Harry disappears. But don't worry, the bridge gets a new alien playmate in exchange. Ooh, she has gorgeous eyes! Then this red shirt vanishes and an alien red shirt materializes in the holodeck and oh my god, this is the best reaction to being leered at by two holodeck babes. Tuvok tries to increase the shields with no effect and oop, now he's gone too! Replaced by this guy who wanders into engineering. All the aliens are shepherded into sickbay, while Chakotay reports that 22 crew members have vanished so far, and the aliens, called Nerians, that came aboard, tell that they've shown up on their colony. B'Elanna says that the switching of personnel could be caused by just about anything, but Janeway is suspicious and wants to keep an eye on the Nerians. Chakotay is more trusting, but Janeway is all like, "Bitch, please, this is why I'm the captain and you're not." Every 9 minutes and 20 seconds, a switch occurs, which means that in 18 hours, the crew will be cleared out entirely. We jump ahead in time to a Janeway voiceover that explains that more than half the crew are gone. She insists that the Nerians be confined and orders a shutdown of everything except the essentials. After working with a Nerian astrophysicist that appears, B'Elanna says that they've discovered a teeny tiny wormhole that is causing the disappearances. Really though? Would a naturally occurring wormhole have a sense of dramatic timing? Because Janeway is outta here! On the bridge, we are introduced to this adorable ensign who is the new chief of security, and reports that Neelix is the next to go, leaving them with only 40 crew members versus over 100 Nerians. B'Elanna is working with the Nerian astrophysicist in engineering, but I don't know why because she's ignoring everything he says. Her scans show up that it's not a wormhole at all. In fact, it's not even naturally occurring, and whoa, this dude gets smacked out! And B'Elanna is held at gunpoint. Aha, so it was the Nerians! Well, obviously. The scientist boops some buttons, moving B'Elanna to the front of the queue, however that works, and she disappears, reappearing in some kind of habitat where she shares her findings with Janeway, who is well aware of the situation, thank you. Some guards show up and yoink her comm badge, but they won't speak or answer any questions. However, they have been supplied with everything else they need to live comfortably. Back on Voyager, the adorable ensign is helping out Chakotay, and seriously, why isn't this woman a main character? She's awesome! There's now only 12 of them left, including a guy named Gennaro, who reports the incident in engineering and is sent to find the missing scientist. Chakotay leaves the bridge to go see the Nerians, and wait, does this mean this woman is now acting captain? Yes, queen! Chakotay discovers the Nerians have escaped and orders those crew who are left to head to the bridge or engineering and keep the Nerians out at all costs. Cute ensign hands out orders and takes out two of the Nerians before getting shot. She'd better get a promotion after this. This poor guy in engineering is outnumbered and overpowered by the Nerians. And it's nice to see rando crew members getting their time to shine. Although I wish Ayala was here, he's the best. When Chakotay's partner disappears, he calls out to anyone left, but he only gets one response from Gennaro. Realizing that it's only 18 minutes before they're both gone, Chakotay orders a mission of sabotage and wishes Gennaro luck. After pulling out some wires, Chakotay gets into a firefight with some Nerians and run, dude! Main power starts going down and the Nerians are having trouble seeing the problem. So can someone turn on some lights? Thank you! Chakotay discovers that the Lanerians are trying to delete the Doctor, so he calls on Gennaro to stop them. But time's already up and Gennaro is gone. With only 2 minutes remaining before it's his turn, he sprints to sickbay and explains the situation to the Doctor, who defends the door while Chakotay downloads his program into the mobile emitter. Knowing he's beaten, Chakotay surrenders. With everyone now in the habitat, some woman who seems completely unaffected by the very bright lights welcomes them to their new home. She explains that the displacement technique is far more effective than getting into a firefight, and Voyager will be used to defend the Nerian people. Wait a second, this woman just wandered into the middle of them all. Why don't they just grab her and hold her hostage? I know there are two guards with guns, but they seriously outnumber them, and they have the element of surprise. Janeway assures this bitch that they will find a way to escape, but she's like, yeah, okay, whatever. Bye! Tuvok, who's been scouting, says there's a natural barrier no matter which way they go. But no time for that, because this rock is glitching and this guy Jarlath comes out to welcome them. His people went through the same ordeal with the Nerians and is fascinated by both the habitat and the food they have to offer, and wants to trade. Because Jarlath can both see and open the portal between habitats, Janeway takes him up on his offer. That night, B'Elanna tinkers with the Doctor's mobile emitter, adjusting what he can see so he can detect the portals. I'm gonna skip over the lame argument B'Elanna and Tom get into, fueled by the Doctor, and go straight to the craft table where Chakotay, Neelix, and Tuvok are constructing weapons. It's the next morning and the Doctor is bored of scanning for portals, but they happen upon one and Jarlath kindly opens it. The group find themselves in either an off-limits area belonging to the Nerians or a Borg habitat. Either way, I'd be Jarlath in this situation.
I don't think we're supposed to be in here.
They find doors that lead into different habitats, while Janeway hacks into the system and finds the information about their environment. It states that the population is 148, which, thanks to some math someone did online, means that since their journey began, Voyager has lost 34 crew members. They discover that altogether there are 94 environments, and geez, how big is the Nerian Empire if they're still displacing people after all that? Their meddling sets off an alarm which alerts the Nerians back on Voyager, and they authorize the use of force to contain the problem. Jarlath, bringing up the rear, is caught and immediately surrenders because all he wants is a quiet life, bless him. His displacement back to his own habitat alerts Janeway and Tuvok to the controls, and with the right security bypass, they could use it to return to Voyager. Tom and B'Elanna get themselves cornered and escape into a frozen wasteland, where they have more relationship junk, and can we just move on, please? The Nerians that followed them collapse from the cold, and are you seriously not going to take their weapons, you dumbasses? Janeway and Tuvok get the Nerian displacer working and put Tom and B'Elanna back in the habitat, while moving the first alien and his buddy into the frozen wasteland. Janeway appears and says basically if they don't give Voyager back and release all the prisoners, she'll leave them and the rest of their crew in this frozen shithole. With no other choice, the Nerians agree. We end this episode with more Tom and B'Elanna bullshit, so let's skip that, shall we? This episode has a very middling rating, but I quite enjoyed it. Aside from the boring Tom and B'Elanna stuff, I really like the idea of non-violent methods of taking over the ship. Firefights can get boring, so to have a more subtle, creeping feeling of dread as the Nerians took over was an interesting change. The best part of this episode was the first half, where they were slowly being switched out. And I like that Janeway went so quickly, along with most of the main cast, because it gave the lesser-seen crew members a chance to shine. Once they got to the habitat, however, I found it ran along the same lines as the season 3 episode Basics, which did it so much better. But with the crew arriving one by one into a community and then breaking into the facility of the Nerians, it gave me kind of Maze Runner vibes. I liked Jarlath as a character, and it was a nice change to come across a friendly character in a hostile situation. I kind of wanted him to join the Voyager crew, but they already have Neelix, so I guess that wouldn't have worked. So there you have it, that was Displaced. If there's an episode of Star Trek you'd like me to cover, pop it down in the comments or come say hi on social media. If you enjoyed this video, then please like, share and subscribe. I'll speak to you soon, and live long and prosper.